Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Getting to the Promised Land, Black America, and the Unfinished Work of the Civil Rights Movement. By Kevin W. Cosby. Narrated by Mirron Willis. Foreword. In the Reverend Dr. Kevin Cosby, the ADOS movement has a true love warrior. And when I talk about love warriors, I am speaking about a specific group of folk who really love the people. You see, when you genuinely love folk, you hate the fact that they are being treated unfairly. You loathe the fact that they are being treated unjustly. And you know that if you don't do something about it, then the rocks are going to shout out. That is the tradition that we in the Black freedom struggle come from. And so it is in these consecrated chapters written by our dear brother, Kevin Cosby. Dr. Cosby understands that reparations is about two things. First, it is about truth. And he knows that the condition of truth is that you must allow the suffering to speak. Second, reparations is about justice. It is about understanding where the damage is, who did it, and then where that offending party needs to direct the repair. The Black freedom struggle in America from the very beginning has always been in pursuit of these two things, truth and justice. And reparations is simply one of the ways in which our quest for truth and our quest for justice is brought to bear on white supremacy, an ideology that says Black history is a curse, Black freedom is a pipe dream, and Black hope is a joke. Now, of course, we know that that is not the case. We come from a great people. We come from a grand tradition. There is no other group of people in the modern world who've been terrorized under slavery and Jim Crow Jr. and Jim Crow Sr. and who have still, despite these horrible experiences, taught the world so much about freedom. There is no other group of people who have been traumatized for 400 years and still manage to teach the world so much about healing. You can hear it in our music. You can see it in the way we connect with one another. And while we as a people have been hated so chronically, institutionally, and systematically for 400 years, we have nonetheless taught the world so much about how to love. Just turn on John Coltrane's Love Supreme, or Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. Listen to Stevie Wonder's Love's in Need of Love Today. Or read James Baldwin's love-soaked essays. Or Toni Morrison's Beloved. See Mama on the stage in Raisin in the Sun. And see how there's never been a character on the American stage full of so much love in the history of the whole nation, in the history of the whole empire. And what Kevin Cosby's book proves is that there ain't no stopping us now. Brother Cosby proceeds from this fundamental truth, that you don't love Black people because you want them to love you back. No. You love them because they're worthy of being loved. And just like tenderness is what love feels like in private, justice is what love looks like in public. Somewhere, I read that love takes away your fear, that love takes away your intimidation. In the Black community, we used to have churches and mosques where we had genuine, fearless leaders. The problem is that in the 1960s, so many of our love warriors were assassinated or incarcerated, and we ended up with polished professionals who acted as if they were leaders when what they really wanted to be was well-adjusted to injustice. I'm reminded about how there used to be a brother named Sylvester on the organ in my church every fifth Sunday. But he's known to the world for the genius that he is as Sly Stone. And Sly Stone wrote a song that went, "Stand." There's a cross for you to bear. Things to go through if you go in anywhere. In other words, we don't need cowards or conformers. If you're scared, get out of the way. Now, that's old school. And what's beautiful is that today, we got new school here. The ADOS movement is the new school. And in this book, Brother Cosby brings a new interpretation of the book of Nehemiah to undergird and inform the righteousness of this new movement of love, of truth, of justice. People have said that the ADOS movement is flawed because they're being so specific when they talk about their group being so distinctive. People say that the ADOS movement is about putting other folk down. But listen to Kevin Cosby's words in this book, and I believe that you'll come away with a much deeper and honest understanding about what this movement really signifies. At its core, Kevin Cosby's book is talking about love. Brother Cosby knows that you don't love black people by putting other folk down. That's white supremacy. Those who espouse white supremacy stand tall by trying to keep us on our knees. We love each other in and of itself. And then, when the love spills over, it's even more real. But let me tell you this. We are in a moment where the polished professionals too often love everybody but black people. That's what I can't stand. Oh no, I'm a Christian. Now, I love everybody. And I'm going to be faithful unto death. But I'm going to tell you this. I'm loving the chocolate side first. How can I not? How can I love the other side if I don't love myself? Love your neighbor as yourself. Learn how to love yourself. And then love your neighbor. And it will necessarily spill over. ADOS has got nothing against other black people. They know that Caribbeans and African folk are beautiful too, but that as ADOS, we need to love ourselves. And in so doing, we can then make sure the love is equally spread. That's what I believe Dr. Cosby's book is here to tell the world. This book demonstrates to us, above all, the importance of loving ourselves first, so that we may properly love others. Cornel West. Preface. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated less than 24 hours after he gave what many consider to be the greatest speech of his life, and in what is now both a poignant and strikingly premonitory aspect of that speech. King reflects on his own mortality, alluding to a scene from the Bible. "Like any man, I would like to live a long life," he says. "Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we, as a people, will get to the promised land." That line, "We as a people will get to the promised land," has occupied a permanent place in my mind. Indeed, it is no great exaggeration to say that my whole life, in one way or another, has been consumed by trying to understand the deeper implications of what King is saying in these words and how they express his sublime vision of the black freedom struggle in America. What I've come to believe is that "We as a people will get to the promised land" synthesizes the most important aspects of his political thought, and that those characteristics furthermore provide the essential model of leadership for those who, like myself, are intensely engaged in the continuation of that struggle, and who aim to help see Dr. King's unfinished work through to completion. For the last 5 years, I have been at the fore of a national racial justice movement made up of the American Descendants of Slavery, or ADOS. The movement's principal objective is to show how the full cost of what it means to be black in America is knowable and calculable only through a person's lineage, as opposed to his or her skin color. This makes a necessary distinction between those in the black American community who trace their lineage to chattel slavery and those whose families voluntarily immigrated to the United States. By specifically focusing on the former group's unique identity and history in America, the ADOS movement can thus most effectively carry on King's legacy, namely, working to obtain the rights of full citizenship for ADOS through a political agenda whose core demand is reparations. In October 2019, the college of which I am the president, Simmons College of Kentucky, the Commonwealth's oldest HBCU, historically black colleges and universities, hosted the first national ADOS conference. Over 2,000 people from across the country attended the event. Among the speakers were the movement's two founders, Yvette Cornel and Antonio Moore. Representative John Yermuth, chairman of the House Budget Committee, legendary activist and philosopher Cornel West, and the Democratic presidential candidate Marianne Williamson. The New York Times assigned a reporter to cover the proceedings, and an article detailing the movement's growth graced the paper's front page the following month. A few months later, ABC News aired a segment about ADOS in which they introduced their viewership to the budding justice movement. My involvement with the ADOS movement has been marked by a religio-political coherence previously unknown to me. That the movement has found an institutional hub here in Louisville, Kentucky, at my church and college, is indicative of the critical role that I believe our institutions, particularly the black church, need to play in our ongoing freedom struggle. The interplay between black institutions and our demand for meaningful inclusion into the United States is central to a theological framework that I have developed in recent years, and which uses the gospel to support ADOS's particular justice claim. From the beginning, there was great synergy between the ADOS movement and an initiative I started in 2015 called the Angela Project. In association with the National Baptist Convention of America, the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship, and the Progressive Baptist Convention, the Angela Project was meant to commemorate the 400th anniversary of black enslavement in America, and in so doing, help educate and mobilize a millions-strong multiracial coalition in the faith-based community to advocate for ADOS in their political fight for economic justice. This is not to say, however, that my past affinities and forays into various Afro-philosophies have not yielded me great insight into who I am as a black person of faith in particular, and also what it means to be a black person in America more generally. Indeed, it is precisely because of those past intellectual pilgrimages that I feel I possess an even fuller appreciation for where I am now in my journey. From the time I was a young boy in Louisville, Kentucky, my parents worked to instill in me a heightened awareness of, and commitment to, our group's struggle for racial justice in America. To study black history was a requirement in our home. My father served as president of the NAACP's Louisville branch. My mother, who was a professional pianist, taught the instrument to Darlene and Vernon King, the niece and nephew of Martin Luther King, Jr. And on several occasions, I recall both he and his father, Martin Luther King, Sr., visiting my childhood home. However, it was not enough to just study black history. I knew that, since our history is so much a part of our present, one must use his or her life as an opportunity to contribute to it as well. So, at the age of 19, while attending Eastern Kentucky University as a history major, I started the student chapter of the EKU branch of the NAACP. In Madison County, where EKU is located, I also established its NAACP county branch, which is still in existence today. During my senior year, I became the pastor of the 175-member St. Stephen Baptist Church, where I worshiped as a child and currently serve as senior pastor. The Church of St. Stephen is in West Louisville's California neighborhood. California is the poorest zip code in the state of Kentucky, and it ranks as one of the poorest and most segregated urban areas in all of America. Today, with over 12,000 members, St. Stephen has the distinction of being the largest African-American church in Kentucky. Upon graduating from EKU, I enrolled in Louisville's Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. There, I intended to incorporate as much Black church history and Black historical theology into my studies as I could. These Black-centric courses were not offered during the regular semester, but rather as electives during the J terms of January, June, and July, a testament to the marginalization of the Black experience in mainstream white institutions. Indeed, it was that feature of the curriculum, along with the fact of Black being hyphenated in the titles of these disciplines, that would prove decisive in shaping both my outlook on society and my religious praxis and practice. I began to realize the extent of the ideology behind creating and sustaining the norm of the white experience in America, and the less obvious ways in which anything that wasn't white was meant to be portrayed as abnormal. In the early 1990s, I enrolled in United Theological Seminary to pursue a doctoral degree in Afrocentric studies. The Afrocentrists believed that Black Americans must recognize the supposedly natural affinity they have with traditional African culture. And in reclaiming that dimension of cultural Africanism, Black Americans can thus unite in solidarity with other persons throughout the Black diaspora in order to create alternative and putatively more authentic modes of being within a paradigm of Western hegemony. My dissertation aimed to bring together William Cross's racial ethnic identity development philosophy and négrescence, a French term meaning conversion to Black, to discover ways by which we might use the Black church as a vehicle to facilitate the conversion in which Blacks become less Eurocentric in their orientation and more Afrocentric. As is apparent, Afrocentrism has had a profound impact on me as a person and in my development as a thinker. It infused in me a necessary conviction that I, as a person of African descent, am exceptional. Having grown up in a society that had sought to shape my perception of Africa as being a continent of savagery and inferiority, I found this new perspective helped me to see how I had been a victim of conceptual incarceration. That is, how I, as a Black person, had been taught to view life chiefly through a white lens. Afrocentrism encouraged me to celebrate my dark skin and my kinky hair. The more I immersed myself in the philosophy, the more I began to see everything through a Black lens. The Eurocentric images of God and Jesus, the biblical imagery depicted by artists of the Renaissance, all of this became intolerable for me. In fact, so great was Afrocentrism's influence, I even began to refer to myself as Bandele, which means child who is born away from home. I will always be indebted to Afrocentrism. However, as my thinking evolved, I eventually became aware of its inherent limitations for the descendants of American chattel slavery. Apart from the suspect historiography at its core, namely that Africa can be so easily abstracted into a neatly unified continent, an imaginary place in which there are not, in fact, many different countries, all with myriad cultures that are distinct to each, Afrocentric politics are diametrically opposed to the political agenda of the civil rights movement led by Martin Luther King, Jr. For King, the civil rights movement, particularly the emergence of Black power, had helped eradicate the pernicious idea in a Black person's head that they were a nobody, that their Blackness was a sign of their biological depravity, or that it meant their being had been stamped with an indelible imprint of inferiority. To use King's own phrase, the civil rights movement had given the Black person a sense of somebody-ness. Of course, the Afrocentrist would not likely object to this statement. However, where Dr. King would part with the Afrocentrist is on the issue of identity and agenda. Describing how these two things are ultimately anchored in America, King once wrote, "Every man must ultimately confront the question, 'Who am I?' and seek to answer it honestly." He continued, "The Negro's greatest dilemma is that in order to be healthy, he must accept his ambivalence. The Negro is a child of two cultures, Africa and America. The problem is that in the search for wholeness, all too many Negroes seek to embrace only one side of their natures. The American Negro is neither totally African nor totally Western. He is Afro-American, a true hybrid, a combination of two cultures." In spite of the psychological appeals of identification with Africa, the Negro must face the fact that America is now his home, a home that he helped build through blood, sweat, and tears. That conviction was the reason that King, prior to his assassination, had been in Memphis for 2 months trying to secure economic and workplace justice for the city's black sanitation workers. That conviction that America owes its black population descended from slaves was why the year leading up to his time in Memphis had been one of such tremendous personal strife for King. It was why a full 72% of white Americans had an unfavorable view of him, and why he had received multiple death threats and suffered numerous attempts on his life. In fact, the airplane on which he had flown to Memphis had been delayed for taking off because it had to be searched for a possible bomb. As a leading advocate for economic justice for ADOS, Martin Luther King Jr. was a lightning rod for white America's murderous hostility to the idea of meaningfully atoning for its legacy of racism. White society would much rather focus on and elevate an exceptional black who has beaten the odds and risen above racism and poverty to become successful. But Dr. King was not concerned about blacks who managed to beat the odds. Rather, he was committed to doing all that he could to reduce the odds of poverty for the black masses in America. It was not me, the people, but we, the people. And while King no doubt believed in justice for all oppressed people, he nonetheless recognized how black descendants of slavery and Jim Crow had a special justice claim with the U.S. government. Today, American society attempts to overlook this fact, instead preferring to group all oppressed people under the moniker people of color. However, to blend ADOS into such a coalition only serves to diminish that group's unique history and the attendant justice claim. ADOS is, after all, the only group whose ancestors were forcibly brought to America against their will. ADOS is, after all, the only group in America whose people were made slaves. And ADOS is, after all, the only group in America against which laws were passed to repeatedly and specifically exclude them from the social, political, and economic rights that are supposed to accompany American citizenship. This is what Dr. King fought against, and it is the fight which we today must continue. And for it, we, like King, must be willing to lose everything without a moment's hesitation. As a member of the baby boomer generation, I was born prior to the landmark civil rights legislation of the 1960s. Today, many boomers are passing from the scene, and it is perhaps only natural to find myself on occasion contemplating my own impermanence here on earth and the legacy that I will leave behind. Presently, the group to which I belong is a bottom caste in American society. This, in fact, has always been the place we were made to occupy. And for every dollar that whites possess, ADOS hold only 10 cents. Not surprisingly, since society is always eager to justify inequality by assigning defects to the victims of inequality, rather than to the system that produces it. There are many who like to believe that disparity reflects the fact that ADOS are poor simply because we make bad choices. But in fact, that utter absence of wealth within ADOS is more appropriately understood as a direct result of centuries of draconian, often state-sanctioned practices that specifically exploited and excluded us. The reality, then, is that it has never been about the choices that ADOS make, but about the choices that ADOS have. It goes without saying that many of my people are not afforded a plethora of choices. But as a leader in the ADOS community, I am saying it. Thus, it is incumbent upon me to make certain that my choices are made with an eye toward increasing the availability of choices for the group. My decision to write this book, which I hope will honor the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. and help facilitate the completion of his righteous justice work for ADOS, is one such choice. It is a choice made specifically for my group, because I too believe that while I might not get there with you, we will get to the Promised Land. Kevin Cosby, September 2020. Introduction. In America, a certain tension has long characterized the relationship between black political activism and Christian doctrine as it is traditionally preached throughout the country. That conflict, perhaps, is to be expected. After all, given the ongoing oppression of the black population in the United States, it is reasonable to question Christianity's relevance when it is so ambivalent toward those numerous violences and existing inequities. On one hand, it is a Christianity that claims to reprove such injustice, and yet, if one visits any number of black churches across America, that person will surely observe how that same Christianity seems to merely counsel us, the principal victims no less, to exercise patience and forbearance while living under precisely those conditions of provocation. This version of Christianity curiously encourages its black congregations to accept that the fulfillment of their freedom is to be found in eternal salvation. This despite our nation's apparent bedrock of truth that God has endowed each and every one of us with the right to liberty here on earth. What are we supposed to make, then, of a Christianity that remains essentially reticent about the fact that from the very beginning, with respect to its black population, the United States has acted in direct contradiction to that supposed belief? Rather, it has sought to radically attenuate the freedom of our community to the point of meaninglessness. Given these circumstances, how are we ever to see the message of Christ and the collective effort to free ourselves from oppression as being divinely consistent with one another? In his seminal work, Black Theology and Black Power, Reverend Dr. James Cone confronted these questions of compatibility head-on. He forcefully argued the essential emancipatory nature of Jesus' ministry and demonstrated how the black freedom struggle, with its aim of liberating black people and setting them on a course of self-determination, embodied a distinctly Christian mission. In so doing, Dr. Cone established the theological underpinnings for a religion that could meaningfully engage with our people's resistance to exploitation and injustice. This Christianity recognized the singularity of the black experience in the United States and respected the indissolubility of black identity. It is impossible for me to surrender this basic reality of blackness for a higher, more universal reality, Cone wrote. Therefore, if a higher, ultimate reality is to have meaning, it must relate to the very essence of blackness. This was Cone's governing proposition, and for him, it would locate God.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.